The word safari is a Swahili word that means journey. Our journey is going to take us across the continent of Africa to meet the animals that make their homes here. Our first visit is to the Ituri rainforest. This is a dense and dark rainforest in the heart of Africa, in a country known as the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Right in the center of the habitat is where you'll spot a dark-colored animal with white stripes on his legs and rump. This is an okapi. Okapi are found nowhere else on the planet except for this one single rainforest, the Ituri. And you may think that the okapi is related to this zebra because of those stripes, but no, they are no relation to the zebra at all. Those stripes are for camouflage to help them blend in to the dark rainforest home. Inside their own ears, clean their own eyeballs, and look right up their own nose. Yum, yum, yum. Gold star to anybody on board that can lick their own eyeballs. In the corner over to the right side of the habitat is where I'm hoping we'll spot our Nubian ibex, the type of African mountain goat. Look up at the tip-tip-top, there's some even up there playing king of the mountain, king and queen. We have kids, moms, and boys in here as well, dads. The males are the ones with the super long horns and the shaggy beard. Nubian ibex are all incredible mountain climbers. They have special feet with curved hooves on the bottom that act like suction cups on the rocks. This allows them to balance on teeny tiny ledges. Some ledges that are only 1 inch wide. Places where their predators can't follow them. Because this is a prey species, a lot of predators want to eat them for lunch. And they have to get away fast. Believe it or not, a baby Nubian ibex is awake, can stand up and even run from a predator when they're only 3 hours old. One of our two Remy zebra mirrors you'll spot here. The second one's a little further along. Did you guys know there are three kinds of zebra? The Grevy's here is the largest, and you can tell them apart by looking, because Grevy zebra have the skinniest and the most stripes and a white belly where the stripes don't wrap all the way around. In addition to being the largest of the zebra, the Grevy zebra is also the most endangered. They have live in smaller family groups of only 8 to 10 zebra across the scrublands of Africa and have lost 70% of their population in the last 30 years due to habitat loss. A Grevy zebra has got their stripes making them special. No two zebras have exactly the same stripes. And look closely, guys. Can anybody tell which side of a zebra always has the most stripes? It's the outside. Y'all should laugh. The jokes will get worse. To the right side of the cliff, in the back cliff, where you'll spot two small African cats called caracal. The word caracal comes from old Turkish terms, meaning black ears. Did you spot their black ears? Caracal are predators. Who knows what a predator likes to eat? Whatever they want to. Caracal have sharp claws and long legs, which they use to hunt mammals, reptiles, and those long legs mean that they can leap up to 8 feet straight into the air to grab a bird right out of the sky. We've got our group of pelicans in the water, and I'll tell you about them in just a bit. And we also have a white bird with black on his wings. That's a European stork. Why is the European stork on our African safari? Well, it's a migrating bird. He lives 3 months of the year in Europe, 9 months of the year in Africa, and I guess the Europeans got a little greedy when they gave it a name. A little bit further along is our beautiful, beautiful, beautiful Stanley Blue Crane. You'll see her on the rock there. The Stanley Blue Crane is the national bird of South Africa. Just like we have the Bald Eagle as our national bird, the Stanley Blue Crane was chosen for its beauty, and I think they chose very well. Now as we move along, you'll see another European stork at the back, and then right up on the point here of the island is one of those pelicans I was telling you about. This is a white pelican. Pelicans are those birds that have that stretchy pouch under their chin called a gular pouch that they use to hunt fish. Pelicans float along the water, and if they spot a fish, they scoop it up, water and all, right out of the river, right into their pouch. A pelican can hold up to 3 gallons of water or 20 pounds of fish inside that pouch when they're hunting. On the island there, facing the train, are two small ducks. Those are white-faced whistling ducks, and another one a little further along as well. They don't quack at all, they only whistle. And
thank you.
they do not have a pouch. Instead, they are a diving bird, and they can dive up to 25 feet underwater to catch a fish when they're hunting. Cormorants are such amazing divers that in some cultures, they actually use them and train them to help them fish. In the clearing, you'll spot two kinds of antelope here. First, you'll see some red antelope, and that's the water buck. And if you want to know what's special about the water buck, take a big whiff of the air. They stink. They have a special oily gland in their fur that makes them smell bad and taste worse. Predators like the leopard know that if they smell that stinky smell in the air, they better leave the water buck alone, because she's going to attack the sun and keep cool. But the most incredible thing about an addax is that these guys can go their whole life and never need to drink water. An addax can get all the water they need straight from the plants they eat. That is a handy adaptation, or should we say addaxation, to living in the Sahara Desert. Our next visit is also to some deserts, but this represents smaller deserts around Africa, such as the Kalahari, and the deserts in Ethiopia and Somalia. Right up front are my favorite animals on the monorail, the Somali wild ass. These beautiful animals are the wild ancestor to our domesticated donkeys. Somali wild ass are incredibly endangered animals. They're part of zoo species survival programs where we breed endangered animals in case we need to put a gun box. And to the right side of the habitat are the tallest birds in the world, the ostrich. Black ones are boys and brown ones are girls. In the middle of the next habitat, look a little bit to the back where you'll see two chocolate birds with pink wrinkly heads. Those are lappet-faced vultures. Hornbill. They're called brown hornbill because they like to run everywhere they go, even though they can't fly. Now, across the river, you're going to see a big, huge antelope with spiral horns, and we'll talk about him in a second, but look to his left. Don't miss that little antelope there with the black stripe on his side, wagging his little tail there. That's our Thompson's gazelle. Thompson's gazelle are the second fastest land animals after cheetah, and it's a good thing, too, because guys, guess what? Cheetah eat. And that big guy, that big antelope with the spiral horns, is a greater kudu. And they have the longest horns of any antelope. All the way in the back there, that's Wester, one of our male grevy zebras. And right up front here is a very strange looking bird. It's a giant gray bird with a naked head and a long beak. This is the marabou stork. Now that naked head means that it eats what? Carry on, just like vultures do. However, that long sharp beak means that they hunt live prey too. Marabou stork will grab a flamingo or even a baby crocodile for a little bit of a snack. As we start to turn, chimps love to play in this habitat, but they don't monkey around because chimps aren't monkeys. They are great apes. There's a lot of differences between an ape and a monkey, but a big one is that monkeys have a tail. Great apes do not have a tail. Can anybody on board guess the rest of the primates in the great ape family? Take a guess. Tell your friends. If you guess gorilla, orangutan, or bonobo, you're right. All those guys plus chimps make up our great ape family. And we would never ever point to a group of chimps and say, hey, look at those monkeys, because they're not. They're going to be as long as two of these train cars. That's 20 feet long, folks. They are the biggest predators in Africa. They're on hot weather. In fact, out of the 19 times that they live around the world, only 5 times live in the cold weather. They just get the best movie deals. There's actually 14 kinds of penguins from hot places. Places like South Africa, Namibia, the Galapagos, New Zealand, and Australia all have penguins. And did you guys notice that every penguin place I just said was all on or south of the equator? Well, that's because every penguin in the whole entire world is found in the southern hemisphere. Polar bears are not. They are found in the Arctic up north. So, in real life, you will never, ever see a penguin and a polar bear in the same place at the same time. Not unless you're watching a cartoon or one of those old Coca-Cola commercials where they live in harmony. I guess we could say that penguins and polar bears are polar opposites. Crossing the plaza, that's our wild encounter stage. Every 30 minutes there's a new program you guys can see right up close. This is our 3 o'clock program, and there'll be another one starting at 3:30, so feel free to hop over there to enjoy some of our creatures right up close. We are pulling into the station, and I remind you to stay seated until the doors behind you open. Front row, step up. Back row, step down.